So, as Dr. Finkel said, my name is Vijay, and the topic, as you can see, is X-CHANT, Next Generation Satellite Network. So we'll go into the background, we'll see what are the current efforts, and I will introduce this new paradigm, and then we'll go into the details of the presentation. So as you can see, our ubiquitous connectivity in rural community is a must. I mean, in any community, it's a must. But there's the problem is that even in the United States, 39% of rural population still lack access to the broadband connectivity. So across the world, I don't know about the Europe, but across the world, 46% of world population lack access to the broadband connectivity. Yes. And this creates a huge digital divide, and that's why it becomes a very important problem to provide connectivity to such challenging environments, which we term as challenge networks. And this is the topic for today. So there are several efforts over the years. And this one is particularly from MIT Media Lab, which I like a lot, and it was proposed in 2004 or so. So it was based on public transportation vehicles, and there, as you can see, these vehicles have Wi-Fi radios, and they act as access points. And they basically travel between the nearest cities and the villages. And it has been deployed in several countries, and it's still in use in those countries. Besides this, there are other efforts which I haven't put here, but the Google project, Loon, everyone is aware of that. So there you have these different balloons which are flying over these different rural areas, and then the users can connect to them through LTE services. Then we have another project from Facebook where you basically have these drones and UAVs flying, and they partner with the local cellular companies, and they try to provide you the limited access to the internet, right? So the problem here is that all these different solutions we have, they basically utilize either short-range standard technologies or long-range cellular technology. With the short-range technology, the issue is that it's not scalable to this 46% of the world population. But for the cellular technology, it's definitely promising. But the problem here is that there does not exist enough interest from the cellular providers to provide connectivity to these areas because it's not profitable. Another issue is that the spectrum resources that they use, they are usually fixed to a certain band, like LTE band or the Wi-Fi ISM bands. And because of that, there is a huge issue that the spectrum resources would be under or over provisioned when they try to deal with heterogeneous data. So for instance, if you try to use LTE band, which offers you very high channel bandwidth, and if you try to send one text data which is few KBs, you are already wasting a lot of resources there. So that is kind of the idea of under-provisioning. For over-provisioning, the same thing, if you take a video into consideration and a low channel bandwidth TV band, for instance. So this kind of motivates our idea. So for that, we already have something called dynamic spectrum access. It was originally proposed for something else, which was spectrum efficiency. So the idea here is that any wireless device can access any license band as long as you do not interfere with the primary users. So as you can see on the right side, if it is open, you can use it. Okay, like the red hop that you see. So that are your wide space channel or unoccupied free channels. And you can use it if primary users are not using it. If they are using it, then it becomes illegal. It's kind of a crime. Yes. I mean, you'll be charged, you'll be penalized if you do that. It's like a jamming attack, right? If you try to use a channel which somebody has paid to use that channel. So like I said, the key objective here was spectrum efficiency, and the reason behind it was that even in like most crowded cities like DC and Chicago, just 38% of license band are used. And if you consider rural areas, let's say in India, 60% of TV wide space channels are always 24 hours available. So you see there's a huge potential of solving the problem of spectrum scarcity if we go with this new paradigm instead of going with the legacy static spectrum policy paradigm. Okay, so that's the whole idea of dynamic spectrum access. And there are different other versions for dynamic spectrum access. So here we're talking about one version where a license, an unlicensed user can use the channel with whatever power, with whatever number of channels they want to use it. So that's called dynamic spectrum access overlay. If you try to coexist with the primary users and you maintain a certain spectrum power, then it becomes underlay. So you are kind of hidden, you do not interfere with the primary users, but you can still operate it. But that's kind of very unpopular. This one is more popular because you see the reason why, right?
So the idea is that you're gonna no longer make this illegal, but you can only get on there when the primary user's not on there, and then do you automatically get kicked off as the primary user?
Yes, so there are key functionality. Yes, so that's called a spectrum handoff. Okay. We'll not go into those details, but I'll be happy to talk more. So here, the idea or the motivation for my work is that DSC is allowed in different bands. It's not just about TB band or GSM band. There are more other bands, which is CBRS band, radar band, even unlicensed ISM bands are there. And there are upcoming millimeter waves, which is like 30 gigahertz to 300 gigahertz. So there's a huge spectrum resources that could be harnessed, right? But the literature, if you say, they focus to one particular band, and that's the key issue, okay? So as you can see there, it's restricted to an individual band. Sometimes they do not even specify what band they are using. So I just put a small, very small sample of the existing literature in the most recent ones. As you see, like, they already define what band they use. They usually consider either a very general band between fmin and fmax, and they say, okay, they have these n orthogonal channels, and it has a certain range, certain band. But, and sometimes they also specify, let's say, a TB band. And then they have these message sizes which are fixed. Like I said, they do not consider message heterogeneity into consideration. So these are the things that we want to address. And that's why we came up with this extended paradigm, which we call diverse band aware dynamic spectrum access. So here the idea is that any wireless spectrum can access multiple spectrum bands as long as you do not interfere with the primary user. And the benefit you see over there is just one small example. That let's say if your objective is end-to-end delay. In that case, if your user is very far from you and the message is just a text message, in that case you may want to go with a TB band because that gives you a good range. But at the same time, you do not need that amount of bandwidth to support a TB band. But if you're extremely close and you want to send a video message, in that case you want to go with a high channel bandwidth even though it doesn't offer you a good range because you are already very close. So those are the optimizations that you may want have to do when you deal with different bands and different messages. But it's a good field for research because it has a direct impact or a direct benefit in terms of improving the communication for heterogeneous messages while exploiting whatever already exists. So we are not creating new spectrum bands. It already exists, we want to exploit that. And this is possible only because of these different electromagnetic characteristics of different bands that they offer. So like for instance, oh, for some reason it's not visible, but here the idea was that even with the same antenna gains, with the same transmit power, with all other factors fixed, different bands have different communication ranges. Similarly, for different bands, this is given by the FCC, so it's not that a channel bandwidth cannot be very huge for smaller bands, but it's what the regulations say, that in US at least, in TB band, you have a channel bandwidth with 6 megahertz, and then it usually increases with increasing frequency bands. Yes?
So how far would the CBRS band be able to range such as a distance?
So it's a very simple equation, right? We have this free transmission equation, and then given the parameters, you can kind of compute what will be the range, right? So since it operates usually in 3.5 gigahertz, it's way less than the TV band, which operates in 600 megahertz. And it's a direct relationship is, I think, a frequency square with distance. That, given that all of the parameters are fixed, antenna gain, path loss factor, frequency, not frequency, like other factors. I didn't get it.
So if I'm in a low range,
yes.
All of the above, all bands, CLT band, CDRS band, and the TV band, or is it only going to rely on CDRS in low range and rely on the TV band?
So you say, like, how do we use different bands?
Yeah.
Among, no, so that becomes an optimization problem, right? So now given a QS demand that you have, it could be end-to-end delay, it could be something else. Given how the nodes are deployed in the network, and given what bands are available, right? It may so happen that channels are not available in that band at that time, at that location. So now you need to find out a way to choose the best band, the best relay node, the best path from a given source to a given destination. And that's what we basically do in this work. But I'm trying to motivate that this paradigm becomes extremely useful, and that's also part of the contribution of this work. Yes?
Do you assume that both the sender and the receiver are capable of using all of these bands?
If
they don't need an intermediate, they're not going to be stealing cycles, so to speak, from the wireless provider who's put up the tower.
No, so that's one of the requirements, that you make sure that you do not interfere with the primary users.
Right, so I mean, both your sender and your receiver have got to be close enough to each other to be able to effectively use whatever band they're currently chosen to use.
Yeah, so we consider multi-hop network.
Okay.
So there will be other intermediate nodes. And that's how you try to find the path between
okay.
the source and the distance.
Okay.
And there are other factors. I just mentioned three factors here, but there are other factors as well. Okay, so yes. Determined by?
If I have a T-Mobile or something, the T-Mobile is just one of the bars. It's actually an alternative source of information.
I didn't get a question.
The service provider is just one of the bars. Establishing an alternative source of
information.
So? I think there are different sides. How this helps us.
So we have. So if you have noticed, we are considering or we are basically establishing a new network, which is a diverse band aware dynamic spectrum enabled network, right? So once we have that network, the idea is that each node is capable of DDSA capability basically, right? So now once each node is DDSA enabled, so it has the capability of harnessing or exploiting all the bands that are available in the area, okay? And then definitely the playground for finding the, let's say, end-to-end this path, whatever the quality of service is. So in addition to the existing network, the only dimension that we bring in this network is the spectrum band. That's what I'm trying to say. So in a general network, you have these different nodes, and you try to find the set of relay nodes for that path between any given pair of nodes, so that whatever your quality of service is, you meet that, or you maximize that. But now besides determining the relay nodes, you also need to determine the optimal bands on which each band should operate on, so that you get the maximum QS path. See what I'm saying?
I think the answer to the question is you ignore the wireless provider.
No.
If the wireless provider is using a channel, you don't use it.
Yes.
And therefore, the only channels you're using are ones that no one else is using at the moment. You
right.
never go through the wireless provider.
Yes.
Therefore, you don't use the wireless provider's routing.
Yes. You only use it on an opportunistic basis or a secondary basis.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, so we propose a routing algorithm, yes. So I'm trying to lay out the foundation of the algorithm that I'm. So like he said, so this is what the network architecture looks like in this world. So here you have these different sensor blocks, are basically the province and villages which generate the messages. And then you have these different nodes, or the data mills we call it. They are equipped with the DDSN node. So if you envision the previous darknet architecture we had, it looks exactly the same. So instead of Wi-Fi radios, now we have DDSN radios. Okay? And that's why I call it next generation, because that's the challenge network that exists. We're trying to replace the Wi-Fi radios with the DDSN radios. And the rest of the things remain the same. Here, since we cannot interfere with the primary users, we need to have a mechanism of channel discovery and selection. So there exists a centralized approach like that, where you have these centralized geolocation databases that maintain the list of available channels at each time and at each location. There are other mechanisms, like sense and use, where you have a dedicated radio that keeps sensing the channel, and then if it's available, you use it. Okay. There are other approaches as well. For instance, it's the newer one where there's a dedicated spectrum sensing framework. So they will give you the idea of what are the channels that are available to the DDSA nodes. So there are different approaches, but this one is the most common one, and this is kind of promoted by the FCC. But yeah, it will work with any sensing approach. So the benefit here is that we do not have to deploy dedicated infrastructure, which was the main reason why cellular providers do not exist in such challenging areas. But the challenges, like Dr. told, that the routing becomes the issue. And why? Because besides mobile data mules, we have other things that exist. We have to make sure that we do not interfere with the prime users. We take into consideration different heterogeneous messages, and then we have the different characteristics of bands that we want to exploit. So since it's a network based on the public transportation vehicles, we model it as a sequencer graph snapshot. And here, the network traffic that we had, heterogeneous traffic, that we kind of put in different bins based on their message sizes. And then the assumption here is that the mobility patterns of transportation vehicles can be sufficiently predicted. So this one is from the UMass DigitalNet data set, which was collected at UMass Amherst. So these are like for two different time periods, morning and afternoon. So by morning, I mean 8 a.m. to 11, and afternoon is 11 to 3, or something like that. And each color represents a bus. If you see, the trajectory of each bus doesn't change much. Yes.
So like, Alice has like some message for Bob, and that message just needs to get to Bob like eventually. But mm-hmm. It could be like a whole day later or something.
Yeah.
Okay.
In the worst case, yes. So it's eventually a delay tolerant network, right? Because the nodes are moving. So.
Right, but so you have this assumption about the mobility.
Yes. Yeah, so as long as we are restricted to public transportation vehicles, it should hold,
Are there any, in rural areas, public transportation?
Yeah.
What
are they?
Well, Greyhound buses.
Yeah.
Okay, so Greyhound bus would be one, right? Mail delivery vehicle, right?
The passenger vehicle.
Yeah. We
couldn't find the data sets for rural areas specifically, that's why we consider the data sets that are available.
I think you need data for rural areas, otherwise it's only hypothesizing. This tells me nothing, this UMass data set about what...
It's a very popular data set that has been used in delay tolerant networks, rural networks.
I'm suspicious about the research, I understand.
I see.
It should not be driven by what's available, but what's appropriate for the research that you present. And what's appropriate for that research is data set that deals with rural Alaska, for instance.
that would be meaningful.
Okay. Yeah, we'll find more data sets. Yeah, so here the routing protocol we propose is a centralized one. And like I said, the objective here is to determine the path route, which is the next hop node set and the optimal spectrum band at each node. And this protocol works in two discrete rounds. So here what we do, in the first round, which is called bootstrap round, here the gateway, or let's say the network manager, he captures the mobility traces for all these buses for the initial, let's say, 3 hours in case of you must determine data set. And there we consider 3 hours because each buses completes the trip at least once within 3 hours. That was the motivation behind 3 hours. But I mean, it can be done for the previous day, for instance, for the entire 24 hours. And based on that, mobility traces that we collect, or the network manager collects, based on that, we do the rest of the steps, which is construction of this space-time band graph, which we'll discuss in the next slide. And then we compute the routing table, which we call a STB routing table, which is based on this space-time band graph. And based on that routing table, every other node will choose the band and forward it to the next relay node based on that routing table. That's the whole idea of this routing protocol. So here, like I said, the space-time band graph. So it's an old topic from 1940s. It was called a spatio-temporal graph, or time-expanded graph, if you're aware of it, by Ford Fulkerson at Princeton. So we extended that approach to multiple bands. So here, since it's a layered graph, it's important that we define what would be the discrete time interval, which is kind of the granularity for that layered graph. So to define the granularity, in our case, it becomes easier because we deal with the messages and we deal with the spectrum bands. So for the messages, we know what's the least message size, for instance. And for the bands, we know what's the maximum channel bandwidth that a certain band will provide. So now that becomes your least transmission delay. So if you take the interval less than the least transmission delay, it's useless because you can't send any message at all. So that's why we consider that least message transmission time as the time granularity. So now taking that, for each layer we have a node V, which corresponds to time layer T and the spectrum band, let's say S. And then we have these two different communication links that we come up with. So the first one is called temporal links. So here, the node stores the data with him for the next time link. So as you can see there, from time 0 to 1, let's say node 0 at time 0 holds onto that data. It doesn't give it to anybody. For the spatial link, it always goes from one node to a different node. So here, you can transmit data from, let's say, node 1 to that's a node 3. So here, this link between these two layers kind of suggests me that the message transmission delay, or the message transmission time that is required to transmit that message, is 1 tau. If it goes to the next layer, it tells me that it's 2 tau or 3 tau. So we always take the discrete multiples of tau. If it's not, we approximate or to the upper bound of that tau. Okay, if it's 6.4, then we make it 7. If it's 5.9, we make it 6. So that's how we create the spatial links. And now the combination of both these links basically becomes the list of communication links for the STB graph.
About how big is tau? Is it a microsecond? Is it 10 minutes?
So that's what I was trying to explain. So tau is the ratio of minimum message size by the band that offers you the best channel bandwidth. So for instance, if your message size minimum is 1 MB, for instance, and the bandwidth is 1 Mbps, then tau is 1 second.
Okay. So it's on the order of a second in general.
Yes, usually. Because even if we take less than 1 second, there won't be any message that you can transmit in less than 1 second. It's useless. We don't have to go less than that. But even if you take this simple example with 2 bands, 4 nodes, and 3 time intervals, the graph would be huge, you know. So So as you can see here, we just have that many nodes. But for each node, we have multiple copies. So that's why even if we can use a very simple Floyd-Wassell algorithm here, it becomes inefficient. Okay? So that's why we propose, or we kind of harness two properties of STB graphs. The first one is that between a given pair of nodes, irrespective of how many bands there are, you are always going to choose a band that offers you the least message transmission time. That's you can prove it. We proved it in the paper here. I didn't show it, but it's pretty intuitive. And the second property is that, if we look at that picture here, that I'm saying if from this T to T dash, if WPT is your least, is your shortest path, then the shortest path between T minus X to T dash will always be less than X plus this time. Why? Because you can always reach to that time layer with the temporal links, just with the temporal links, right? So it has to be either less than that or that's the worst. You can't go beyond that. So that's why my time complexity can be decreased from V cube, S cube, T cube to V cube, T. Okay? So this is all we did in this work. Now it's just about, so this is how the routing table looks like. So here, for message type 1 to destination node D at time T, so we tell it whether we use temporal links. So for instance, we store for 2 tau, and then we forward to K on band 1. So these are the decisions we make here. Yeah, again, because it's sufficiently predictable, it's not always true that you always will have the mobility which was similar to the previous step, for instance. So in that case, what we do, we hold on to that message, okay? And we only follow what the routing tables ask me to do. So for instance, if for some reason, for instance, for jam or accident, for other purposes, the node is not there when it was supposed to be. So we keep that message, and then we try to send that message on the next time slot, depending on the rule that was laid out in the routing table. Okay, and there could be a better approach, but for now we consider a very simple approach. And we see very good results with the data set we have considered. So these are very standard parameters that we have considered. As you can see, different message sizes and the bursty traffic, and then with these different sensor blocks. And so this data set had 30 buses, but it was collected for 3 months. But what happened, for most of the buses, we had GPS traces less than 50% of the day. So then we had to throw out the unwanted things. So we just end up with 11 vehicles. So these are different state-of-the-art protocols that we compared with. Since they don't have the concept of a spectrum band, we extended it to the spectrum band. And that was the logic behind it, that we always choose the band that gives you the least delay. And we see that the results are pretty good. That brown line is our approach, and then the green line that you see is in the ideal case. So here we learn and apply on the same day. So definitely it improves, does much better, but we also do much better compared to other protocols, except the packet delivery. Like in the delay, in the energy expenditure, and everything else, we do way better. Even it's scalable, so we saw it for different node densities. And then these are the concluding remarks, that we propose this architecture, we propose this new model, and then the routing protocol we had. There are other issues that we want to investigate in future. I won't go into the details, but here we're trying to make it work with different realistic parameters, like when the node has limited memory, when there are way limited channels for different bands, when we have MIMO capability, we have multiple transmitters and receivers, how do we deal with this? So these were all centralized approaches, so now we are looking into the distributed approaches. So here we are investigating this reinforcement learning thing, and then also the multi-objective reinforcement learning thing. These are our data, and this is a small test bed we have in our lab. We just have 2 nodes. I can't really test a routing protocol, but we want to do that in the near future. Yeah, these are some future directions that we have. Yeah, thanks. So this is the vision.
All right, well, we've already got lots of questions. Thank you very much. I'm sure Vijay will be available in the few minutes. future here to ask him other questions. But now it's